Okay, well, I said let's keep it brief. Thank you for the time. Please answer any question, Mr. Forman. That's all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Forman.
Higgins.
I mean, Mr. Higgins, Mr. Forman, you may proceed, sir.
Oh, excuse me.
May it please the court?
Yes, sir.
Counsel. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury. Morning.
Good morning.
My name is Larry Forman, and I'm the bad guy here today. I'm a criminal defense attorney. We have a bad rep. I'm aware of it. I know it. One question I want to ask you that I want to start out with is, how many of you, when you walked in this building today, and you saw Mr. Hill's been sitting there right next to me after you knew Mr. Higgins introduced himself, I work for the Commonwealth, I'm the one bringing the charges. How many of you, when you walked in this room just a few minutes ago, looked at Mr. Hillsman and said to yourself, well, I wonder what that man is innocent of? What is that man innocent of? No, you all thought like, oh, I wonder what he did. What did he do wrong, right? You're shaking your head no?
I thought, what is he charged with?
Actually, what is he charged with? I like that. See, I try cases all over the state, and I get various different answers. So I want to hear from you guys, because I've had lots of different experiences with various different juries. And the most common answer that I get is they look at my client, and they think, what did he do? But I like your answer, Ms. Ms. Morrison. So could you tell me a little bit more? What were your first impressions when you walked in?
Well, I'm interested in what is happening, this process. I've never been on a criminal case before. And I served yesterday on a civil case, and I enjoyed that. And I enjoy hearing both sides of the case, and I enjoy getting to come to a conclusion with the jury. And I don't want to come into anything with presumption. I just want to have a, it's blank until people start to tell me.
Does anybody agree with Ms. Morrison? It looks like just about everybody. Does anybody disagree with Ms. Morrison? Or have like maybe a different opinion on the issue? Because see, the law in the United States of America is very straightforward and direct. We are presumed innocent of whatever crime alleged until the government, that's Mr. Higgins, the prosecutor, proves his case. And this is, I was a little shocked that he didn't use this language when he was asking you all questions. Beyond a reasonable doubt, that's the standard. Now, a lot of prosecutors like to shy away from that standard because it is an extraordinarily high standard. And I don't blame them. But that's the law, right? So, does anybody have a problem with that standard? Does anybody think that it's too high for a criminal case? Maybe it should be lower, like in a civil case. Do you remember what that standard was in the civil case?
We didn't have to prove it beyond a reasonable doubt. We had to, it wasn't unanimous. We just had to take our facts and decide together what was high. And it had to be 9 out of 12. So
9 out of 12.
Yes.
Here, well, we're not going to have 12 today. This is a district court case. So we're going to have 6. And I believe we may be selecting an alternate. We may have 7 just in case. So, unfortunately, one of you will have to sit through this entire day and then go home. And that's just the way it works. But, like you said, the law requires you all to be unanimous in criminal cases. Does anybody want to tell me why they think it has to be unanimous? Anyone other than Ms. Morrison? I bet none of you know.
Would it
because it shows it beyond a reasonable doubt if all the jurors agree.
Mr. Sloan, tell me more. Extrapolate, and I heard you. I'll get back to you.
Well, it's just another way of assuring somebody who is not proven beyond a reasonable doubt guilty of the crime.
Has anyone seen 12 Angry Men with Henry Fonda? That's the classic scenario, right? 11 jurors are on one side, and they're saying, guilty, let's get out of here, let's go home. But then one juror goes, well, wait a minute. Let's look at the evidence. How about we actually do our job? And, you know, obviously they take it to an extreme. I mean, I don't think those, I hope the dear God goes those things on happen in real life. But it's Hollywood and they're portraying the movie. But that's exactly what it is. And the unanimity of the jury is a fail-safe mechanism to make sure that guilty people go to jail and innocent people do not go to jail, right? Then everybody agree with that. It seems fairly straightforward, right? Ms. Willis, you have something? What else could a criminal conviction do to an individual? To keep you from getting jobs. Ms. Isaacs, thank you.
Incarceration,
most important one, jail time. Criminal offenses, the reason that they're unanimous is because at the end of the day, the individual may go home and die, right? Their liberty gets taken away, their freedom gets taken away. Civil cases, Ms. Morrison, they're just money. Money going from point A to point B. How much do I owe you? Am I liable for this? And do you get paid at the end of the day? Everybody goes home, either with full pockets or empty pockets, depending on, are you on the winning side or the losing side, right? Not the case in a criminal case. So, and let's talk about the standards here just for a little bit. So we talked about the civil standard. The civil standard, the actual language, is preponderance of the evidence. You guys will never need to know that in a million years. But preponderance of the evidence, as they taught us in law school, is just like an oof above 50%. That's what preponderance of the evidence is. Where does the scale, you know, imagine Lady Justice with her scales, where does it tip? Ever so slightly. That's preponderance of the evidence. Now, there is another standard that we haven't talked about yet. And that is the standard that allows the government to take your children away from you. Your parental rights can be deprived, depending on the circumstances, obviously, and the facts of the case. And that standard is called clear and convincing. It is above the standard for civil cases, but it is lower than the standard that we have in this courtroom today. Now, by law, I can't give you a definition of beyond reasonable doubt. I can't do it. Some states allow it, Kentucky doesn't. I don't know why, it's just the way it is. But the closest thing I can tell you is to bring you to the understanding of how important your job in here today is this man right here, this man who hired me. Yeah, he hired me. Yes, he paid me. He paid me money to be here today. I don't work for free. I'm doing a job. He came to me and said, Larry, I'm innocent of this. I need your help. I need your help to prove to the world that I did not do this. This is why we're here today. This is the only reason. There's this guilty plea form. You just fill out, you sign on the bottom, file it away, and you go home. You admit guilt. End of story. Mr. Hilton said, I'm not doing that because I didn't do it. And he's asking for your help here today. So I want to go back to the question of how many of you, when you walked in here, thought, I wonder what he's presumed innocent of. That's what the law requires you to do. To sit, and you'll be seated in this box once we're all sorted out. We have our seven individuals. And you'll be listening to the evidence that will come from that witness stand. It will come from this TV screen. We do have video evidence in this case. And it will be your job. And it's, I promise you, it is a very difficult job. There's no sugarcoating it. Because a man's life is in your hands. Is anybody here religious? Spiritual? That works. Ms. Dries? No, I'm sorry. Skelly. I apologize, I went a little too far. Ms. Skelly, do you feel that you can be in judgment of someone else for their deeds? Does anybody agree or disagree with Ms. Skelly? Do you? Yes, Ms. Tugwell? Oh, I thought you were raising your hand. You're just, well, I'm going to pick on you anyway. You got your cell phone, sorry. Did you hear what Ms. Skelly said about spirituality? Are you a religious individual? So-so? That's okay. I don't know, I'm like an atheist at this point. I used to be religious, and then all this stuff went on the road. I kind of started losing faith. But I'll leave you alone with that. Well, someone who is more religious or spiritual, as Ms. Kelly said, do you feel like maybe this is not the right place for you? That maybe you don't feel like you have, I don't know if I want to call it the right, but the reason I ask this question is because it has come up in past juror questionnaires. If you have like a conviction that you cannot determine the guilt or innocence of someone, if you have a religious conviction, you know, some people say this is the one I got actually, only God can judge someone. I'm sorry, I can't judge someone. Ms. Isaacs, you're nodding your head yet? Just listening? Not agreeing?
I'm an active listener.
You're an active, okay, I'll note that. I've noticed, you've been very, yes. But sometimes when you nod, I'm like, oh, she has an answer, that's why I get thrown off. Does anybody have any sort of, I mean, I'm not talking just like a minor one, like a strong religious conviction that, look, I can't be in judgment of someone else. I know I'm not judging for heaven or hell. You know, I'm deciding guilt or innocence, but does anybody have an issue with that? No? Okay. So, and by the way, the whole beyond a reasonable doubt standard that we talked about, that's going to be a going theme throughout this case. You'll hear it in closing arguments again, because it is the law. And you'll hear it from the judge. The judge will be reading instructions at the end of this case that will state exactly that. It will state the standard. So, let's talk about alcohol a little bit. I think everybody on the panel, I saw hands being raised when Mr. Higgins, the prosecutor, asked you all about, I mean, I don't want to get too personal, you know, are you a drinker, are you not a drinker? I'm not a drinker myself, personally, just a personal decision that I made a few years ago. I don't care if you drink or not. You've been around people who have consumed alcohol, correct? Has anybody never seen an individual consume alcohol in front? I mean, I don't know, you may be a hermit, which I'm not going to hold against you. It's possible. I'm just wanting to see it. I don't see any hands. Okay. All right. So you've seen what alcohol does to the body, right? And you've seen the effects of alcohol on the body. You may have seen it on yourself. You've seen it on other people. So my question to you is this. When you see someone invited drinking alcohol, do the effects happen immediately or do they happen over time? Over time. Why?
Body weight.
Body weight. Gender.
What you've eaten or not eaten.
What you've eaten or not eaten.
How much you've had to drink.
How much you have to drink. What you're drinking.
Your tolerance for alcohol.
Your tolerance for alcohol.
Combination with any medication you might be taking.
Combination with medication you might be taking.
Potential predisposition for alcoholism on your family DNA.
Genetics. Yeah, potential predisposition for alcoholism. Is that what you said? Yeah. Genetics, your genetic predisposition for this. Anything else? And we all agree that as an individual consumes alcohol, does anybody think that effects are immediate? Now, I do not anticipate the evidence in this case to show anything other than alcohol. I'm glad you brought that up. I do not anticipate that there's going to be anything about medication or marijuana or cocaine or anything like that. This is an alcohol case, pure and simple. Okay, so I just want to get that out of the way. Has anyone ever been in an accident? Sometimes everybody raising their hand. Me too. I've been in two accidents. Now, it's going to sound like a terrible question. Don't want to ask it, but I have to. Have you, and we can go up with a match. When you were in the accident, were you under the influence? You were sober, right? Do only drunk people get in accidents? Sometimes it's operator error. Sometimes it can be someone else's fault. Right? Tell me about your experiences. Ms. Isaacs, and by the way, again, feel free, we can go up to the bench. We do not have to discuss this openly. I know this may be very private and I do not want to intrude. Also very humble. So, have you been personally involved, or other people have? Is that what you're saying?
I've been passenger.
Passenger in other people's vehicles where that happened. Okay. Has anyone been in an accident where they've been the driver?
Yes.
hit and run, basically, yeah. Without a hit.
Right.
Oh, that's the shittiest, I'm sorry. That's the worst. Because now you got to call the insurance company, and they're like, yeah. Anybody else? Mr. Sloan.
Yeah, I was in a very bad accident coming back from Little Rock, Arkansas to Louisville about 96, I think it was, and a vehicle that was in front of me had a homemade trailer, and the back end of a pickup truck that was stacked with radiators, very, very hot.
Ooh.
And the trailer came loose to cause an accident in front of me. And I swore to avoid it, and I wound up hitting the truck that had been going down the trailer. And I totaled the car. And it injured my wife very badly. So it was 2 days after Christmas. It was in the morning. I hadn't been drinking or anything. I don't know. It just it happened. And it was just a negligent person with this homemade trailer that came off of
it. It disassembled in the middle. Oh, wow. That is terrible. Do you feel like, I mean, this is a stupid question. Do you feel like you were at fault for that accident?
Well, I thought about it many times. I don't think I was, but I mean, if I had spent another minute at the gas station I had just stopped in, I wouldn't have been in there. I was just going to always have this idea that, well, if I'd only done this, it wouldn't have happened.
We'll always have that. Hindsight, long plus what I could have done. Yeah. And you were sober, right? Driving, and this happened to you, right? Anybody else?
Mr. Foreman, real
yes,
quick.
Sir.
We've been going an hour and a half, and I want to make sure everybody on the jury's okay. Does anybody need a break? It doesn't matter if you do. Okay, please continue.
Thank you, Your Honor. I want to hear from someone who has not. Ms. Willis, yes.
I was driving, I was 16 in my mom's car, and I slid on the ice and she rode somebody. It was totally in my fault.
Well, it was the ice's fault.
I was 16 and it
was there. I'm teasing. I understand. Lack of experience, right, operating a motor vehicle. You're in a brand new circumstance. Was it the first time you were driving in cold weather, on ice, you know, all these factors come into play when you're operating a motor vehicle. Even dead sober, you can create situations where, or something creates a situation around you that creates a dangerous situation, right? Anybody else? Ms. Williams?
Yes. I was a young teacher many years ago and heading to work and was on a country road. I didn't know they were doing road work because they didn't have proper signage at the end of the road. So I came around the curve and all of a sudden I saw these people in the middle of the road. So as I watched people scatter, I went off the side and towed my car. But I didn't hit anybody.
Excellent.
My car was totaled. You know, I wish they had the right sign. I didn't know they were doing any work. So,
that's
I was lucky.
That's called city negligence, when they don't put up signage.
That's what I felt.
Yeah.
I can still see the vision of those men scattering everywhere. You know, I moved really quick.
Thank God, right? So, and I've been, you know, I'm not going to go into detail, but I've been in an accident myself. Twice, actually. Once was my fault, the other wasn't. I got rear-ended on Breckenridge, and that was the latest one, and then I had another one prior to that. That one we won't talk about. It was my fault. But this is an accident case. You will hear evidence. This is why I'm asking you these questions. When an individual is under the influence, right? We talked about how we've been around individuals who have consumed. What sort of signs have you seen these people display when they reach a level of what you might call intoxication?
Slurred speech.
Slurred speech?
Oh, the voice gets louder.
The voice gets louder.
Unsteady gait.
Repetition. Mm-hmm. Saying the same thing over and over.
Repetition, saying the same thing over and over. Being a little more clumsy, not able to manipulate the body as you normally would.
Being more confrontational.
More confrontational.
Overly happy.
Overly euphoria, right? Overly happy. What else?
Lack of judgment. Your judgment kind of goes out the window.
Impaired judgment.
Yeah.
Tell me more about that.
Decisions you would normally be like, no, that's not a good idea. You're like, you know what, why not? You just don't, you're just all rationale goes out the window. Like, I mean, it's just when I used to drink. It's like, I had a student, you know, and then I'd be like, why did I do that? Because I don't really do these. I'm not gonna elaborate
it anymore.
That's why I couldn't drink it.
Sorry?
Blackout?
I mean, we're talking about the extreme now, right? This is when you have so much alcohol in the body, you can no longer function. But blacking out is one of them. We've all seen it, right?
Depth perception. I think I said depth perception, or like making judgment calls on how close you are, how far back you are, or totally my grade.
Anyone else? These are great answers. How about slow reaction time? Aren't you a little bit more lethargic, right? Because alcohol is what? Makes you sleepy. It's a depressant, right? It's a central nervous system depressant. It slows the body down, right? Has anyone here ever been to Knoxville, Tennessee? That's a terrible place to take, Larry. Why would you take that? Has anyone here ever been to Paris, France? I'm trying to find a place where, like, no one's ever been. All right, let's imagine, I don't want to waste your time, let's imagine an imaginary place, a city you've never been to, okay, in your mind's eye. A city you've never been to. You've been invited for a wedding. And you're driving around, you got your GPS going, maybe it's getting a little dark, okay? And maybe you're close to your destination, and maybe you feel a little lost, but you got your GPS, you're good, you know where you're going, but in a brand new place. You don't know the city, you don't know the town, you don't know the people, you're just here, you do the wedding, enjoy yourself, and get out. And as you're driving, you're almost to your destination, you see those lights, those bright red and blue behind you. Ms. Green, what do you feel? What is your first impression when you see those?
Wondering why, I feel very anxious. I'm sure about it. I miss something that I know I'm going
to. Anxious? Wondering what did I do wrong, right? Ms. Ada, same question.
Definitely, my pulse races, my blood pressure goes up, and especially when I don't think I did anything wrong. I mean, my initial is I'm driving along, I'm at the speed limit. Why are they pulling me over?
What did I do, right? And what happens when your pulse goes up?
Get more anxious.
Get more anxious, right? Blood starts pumping, you get all those K chemicals, maybe adrenaline. Sorry?
Adrenaline.
Adrenaline? Is it Ms. Kalinsky? Same question, Ms. Kalinsky.
Yes.
What do you feel, like adrenaline?
Well, yeah, I mean, because I'm a very anxious person anyway, and when I'm hard, because you just get that.
Adds a little stress to the situation, right?
Yes.
You're not just like, oh, how's it going, officer? You're not like calm, cool, and collected, like you're talking to your sister, right?
Like, even if I know I didn't do anything, if there's a cop pulling up behind me, I'm just, what did I do? Like, I'll be like looking around for something that I could possibly, like, I don't like being pulled over. Not a fan. So try to.
Is anybody a fan of getting pulled over?
Try to.
I think you're not alone here, Ms. Kalinsky. I think we're all in the same boat. No, that's, I agree. Mr. Sloan, same question. What is your first impression, your first feeling in that situation?
Well, either I was doing something wrong or I wasn't. And,
well, it sounds like that, doesn't it?
Yeah, and if I don't know why I'm being pulled over, I still act the same. Though I wasn't, that is, I get my license out to accommodate for the wheel, roll the window down, and wait for the officer to come. Generally,
what do you feel when you first see those lights inside?
Well, I think I do feel some anxiety that I've driven over 1.5 miles and it's happened to me in my career. And generally, just try to be calm and cool, but respectful.
If you don't mind my asking, since you know your mileage so well, are you former commercial driver's license operator?
No, no, I was traveling sales.
Traveling sales, yeah, okay. Doesn't do an extra.
50,000 miles a year. Still like 50 years.
It's a nice tax deduction if you're going to.
Yeah,
that's,
yeah.
There was some of that.
Ms. Puck. Mr. Is it Fasnet?
I would always try to know what's my fault. Like anything else, even though I'm driving good, remember I'm just looking at CBS here, the places are confused, and it's moving. I always ask them what's my fault, even if I was on the track, what's my fault? That's all.
Like, what did I do, right? What are you feeling inside? When that happens,
what? Is it
got that internal dialogue going on top of everything. I like that.
Absolutely.
Check yourself.
That's, and one time it was dark. One night it was dark. And I think that whether it's day or night makes a difference, at least that's for this person. One night I was driving home and there was a light flashing. And I stopped. And it wasn't a police person. It was a person who was a wannabe who decided when to stop.
That reaction would have all been conditioned into it. They were taking advantage of that. So I'm glad you got out of there. Okay.
Yeah, I did. But my first impulse is to behave, is to be polite and do what they ask. You know, that's, to me, that's a common thing to do. But.
And then what happens when you do everything they ask? You either go home or you go to jail, right?
That's right.
Officer discretion.
I will. Whatever. Find out.
Counsel, let's approach bench. Okay, so I'm going to give you ample time to go here. I've been going almost 45 minutes now, and we need to move to go.
I was just, Your Honor, since I realized we have ample time, since the witness is not going to be available until 1 o'clock.
He's got a police officer you want to put on.
I was just trying to use
it. But he's got a police officer you want to put on.
Okay, I'll wrap it up, Your Honor. Okay. May I have just a few more minutes?
Sure. I'm just saying, if you don't want to get this done in a day, otherwise, you're going to have to come back tomorrow. Because at the rate we're going, it's going to be a little bit of a police officer.
Understood, Your Honor. Right. I'll move up, move along.
Ms. Shipley, have a seat somewhere, please.
So I'm just going to skip to the end here. In this room, there are two groups of people. I don't know if y'all realize that. Well, technically three, but we'll talk about the last group first, because it's the most important. That is the judge. The judge doesn't belong to any group. The judge is neutral. And I always try to come up with analogies, and I think analogies work. The judge is kind of like the referee, not trying to downplay your role, Your Honor, in any way, shape, or form. But the judge basically makes the calls. If there's an objection, if there's somebody's trying to bring in evidence that they shouldn't be bringing in, or anything of that nature, the judge is the one who makes the call. Okay? Then the other group in this room is the government. The government is Mr. Higgins, his assistant, Officer Fritz, other witnesses that we're bringing on, Officer Lenoe. They all work for the government. Now, I noticed during voir dire, Mr. Higgins pointed out that he represents the people. This is where prosecutors sometimes get their wires crossed. Because you are the people. Mr. Hillsman is the people. Mr. Bates, Ms. Shipley, myself, and all of you, we are the people. This is what the Constitution was crafted to protect. This is the group that is protected by the Constitution. The government is not included in that group. They are not the people. So sometimes prosecutors like to cross that line and say, yeah, lump themselves in. Yeah, we're one of you all. We're one of the people. That is not the case. They're here to do a job. And that is to convict Mr. Hilsen. Does anybody have a problem with the fact that they don't belong to that same group that we all belong to? A strange question, I know. But this is exactly what the drafters of the Constitution wanted to protect us from. Make sure that they're held to their standard of beyond a reasonable doubt. And that you are the final frontier. You are the safety valve to make sure that innocent people don't go to jail. Only guilty people go to jail. It's going to be your job, and at the end of this trial, we'll come back, and we will ask that you return a verdict of not guilty for Mr. Jamal Hills. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we're now going to take a short, you are going to take a short break. The sheriff will accompany you outside the courtroom. Must remind you now, as well as each time you might leave the courtroom, do not discuss this case with anyone, nor form an opinion about it until all the evidence is heard. Report any attempts to discuss the matter with you to the court immediately. Thank you. You can bring your drinks back in, and we're going to be selecting a jury, and we'll call you back in a few minutes, okay?
All right.